super excited about our next guest, Deepika Rao, one of the youngest lady CEOs in the Tata Group. She is the first lady to head an IHCL group company. In 2018, IHCL, which is the Indian Hotels Company Limited, appointed Deepika Rao as the MD and CEO of Roots Corporation, a fully owned IHCL group company which owns and manages Ginger Hotels. What makes this interview so important for our channel is that it has generally been seen that most hotel companies usually have male CEOs. And prior to Deepika, there have been many women in the senior management position, but none of them made the cut to the CEO level. How she leads this male bastion, how she manages her work-life balance with a young daughter who was just 6 months old when she was offered this position, and how she continues to navigate the pandemic, learn this and more in this upcoming conversation, which has been an absolute delight for me as a host.
You're watching Not Just Auntie with Suman Adepalli.
Hi, Deepika. It's my pride and honor to have you as a guest on Not Just Auntie, much awaited interview. You're a benchmark to a lot of women leaders, especially in the male bastion, which is the hotel and tourism industry. To see a woman CEO and at your age is a big inspiration for all of us aspiring professionals. And I'm so, so happy to have you on the show.
Thank you, Suman. Thank you so much. Looking forward to chat with you.
So my first question is that when we look at the hotel industry per se, maybe because it's a very physically demanding industry, correct me if I'm wrong,
no,
we don't see many women leaders. What is your view on this? Like, why is it that, you know, we can just count women leaders in the hotel industry on our fingers? Like, a lot of women do reach senior level positions, but not many CEOs.
Right. So my own view on this is I don't think it's specific to this industry. I think it's there's nothing different or significantly differentiating this industry from another for why the funnel narrows as, you know, we move up in different levels in the organization. So nothing more demanding or less demanding of this industry. So I would try to think it's more agnostic of the industry. It's a similar thing of how the journey should happen from the entry level into the middle management, into senior, and then to lead a company, which we always see it keeps getting narrowed. And, you know, and at Ginger here, for example, we have almost like 24% of our workforce are women. But now if I were to be very critical of it, I would see a large percentage of that is only at the entry level. At our middle manager level, who are ready to then become head of functions, you know, and then move into leadership roles, it starts to really narrow. So now I think our whole organization's focus is, you know, how should we nurture this journey? So I think it's the same thing. I don't think hotels any different from the others. It's just the same ratio. We have good entry level, and all of you as customers, I'm sure, interface with a lot of women colleagues when you visit, let's say on a holiday or on a business trip, checking you in or at the restaurant or at any of the wellness facilities, for example. I'm sure you bump into a lot of women colleagues, and even those companies who are contracting rooms, you know, a lot of women in the sales function. But, you know, just to take that great talent from the entry to the mid senior and then to lead a company. So similar thing that is with other companies or other industries is with ours. With this, it's more about getting the women to really traverse that journey and not leave it halfway.
Right. You're absolutely right. And in fact, what you're saying is true. I was just trying to find another reason. It normally is the same reason which Indra Nui says that, you know, the career clock and the biological clock, they do not match. So that takes me to the next question, which is something I know just because you shared this with me that your child was very young when you were offered the position of CEO or the interim.
Right.
And having experienced something similar when in my career at the same time when my child was really small, I gave up a job that I loved. So how did you manage to hold on to your career? And if you could just share this with us.
For sure. Yeah, so my daughter was born in 2014. Like all women do, I'd taken that maternity break and packed in all the balance leave I had into it. So I got a period of 6 months. So I returned to work in the month of January, and things were changing in my company. I was with Roots Corporation then, where I am now also. In between, of course, I had a stint with Indian Hotels. But at that time, when I came back post-maternity leave, our CEO was retiring, or his tenure was coming to an end. And I think the company's board was in looking out or were already in the midst of conducting a search. I was a functional head. I was looking after two functions on development and projects. So I'd come back, and it was in the month of January, around February or so, there was a conversation that maybe the search will take some more time. So I got a call, I think it was in February, where I was asked to be the interim CEO till the time that the search is successfully concluded. My daughter was all of 6 months, you know, so maybe similar question that you probably faced. At that time, my home, fortunately, I mean, the way things worked out was in Bombay, the commute times are really long and
nightmare.
Yes, I was fortunate to actually, the Ginger office was in Vikhroli and I live in Mulund, and it's just a 20-minute drive, especially in the middle of the day, you can do it quite easily in 20 minutes. So I was still nursing my child. But I discussed this at home with my husband, and my father-in-law is also with us. So that's the size of our family, four of us, my daughter, my father-in-law, and my husband. So I had anyway started coming to work. So there was already some help at home to look after my daughter. And while the responsibility was expanding, everybody was very keen that I must try it out. And probably just the travel, we'll have to plan a lot more out of Bombay. But, you know, the same routine continued. I would drive back during lunch to get back home, have my lunch at home quickly. Or sometimes, actually, I must correct myself, I always ate in the car. I didn't eat at home because I would want to turn around fast. So I would eat. Actually, the car would come from home with my lunch packed. I would eat while going so that when I reached, I'm all done. I would just head to my daughter immediately, nurse her, and then come back. So probably I spent more time on the road than in the house, and I would be back. And so I think that support system, even something simple of having a driver to drive you up and down, helps, you know. I mean, you're not then hailing public transport or figuring out how you're going to do that. Lunch was ready and sent, so I didn't have to worry that I got to come back. And so I definitely benefited from having this help at home. So, but that's how I managed. And, you know, there was no feeling of guilt. All my members of the family never made, or even for that matter, those who helped me, whether it's my team at home, no one held a grudge that, you know, why is she doing this and all of that. I didn't get those looks, if I can put it like that, you know. So
I think that's very important, that you're not made to feel guilty for leaving the small baby. And
right. And that's how we managed to traverse that. And I actually did this for close to about 90 days before the new CEO joined. And so that was my first stint with taking larger responsibility with a young child. And maybe in that sense, timing was good that it was a short period, so not too much of outstation travel that I had to do, and I was able to manage it in this fashion.
Wow, so actually it's very inspiring that I think you've put some pointers that, you know, have a support system, delegate what you can, like driving, cooking,
yes,
and of course you should have a supportive spouse. I think that's the key point. So yeah, supportive spouse is a big element of flying in your career. I think it goes both ways, even for men. You have to have a supportive spouse. So that's great, actually. So before you, Deepika, IHCL has had some women leaders, still does.
Yes, still does, yes.
But you're the only one who has gone to CEO position. So again, to ask you, and I know you're very humble and you may not want to say this, and I know about you is that you have got extraordinary communication skills. I mean, when I've interacted with you in the past, but what else is it? Like, what do you think is a game changer for a lady to reach this position?
I look at it like this from my own personal experience, is that you always need somebody to nudge you a bit. I think women on their own tend to be very self-critical. You always want to be 200% ready for something. You know, if you're 70% ready, forget what others might think. You will fall short. In your own assessment, you'll keep thinking you're not ready for it. You know, I mean, if you think of any aspect, not just the job, but, you know, you tend to be, I don't want to generalize here because I know all of us are different individuals, but my own sense is looking at some of my own friends and all of that, we tend to be more self-critical. So I'm not different. I also come from the similar bent of, you know, thinking that I need to be really fully ready for it. So what helped in my case was that I did have somebody in my life who was a big nudge, you know. You need someone to nudge you and say that, you know, you have it in you, just to reinforce, revalidate. It's not that one is suffering from an inferiority complex, but you need some revalidation. You need a bit of a nudge. You need to also hear that it's not that everybody who then steps up is like done, is fully ready, right? It doesn't happen like that. I mean, if you're going to do something the first time, then it is what it is. It is the first time. So it can't be that you've already experienced it. There has to be the first time. And many of people, irrespective of gender, are not fully ready for what that first time is going to be. So you're absolutely fine. You're not the exception. You're the norm. So I guess you need to hear that. You need that revalidation. And I got that from my husband. And I also think he was also very encouraging and sometimes more ambitious for me than I am for myself. You know, so maybe it helps that we were in college together, so we know each other for a long time, and probably has a good understanding of what he believes my potential is. So he would give me that nudge, you know, send that email, say you're ready. So I think that's what really worked for me. To be able to make that little leap from...
So fabulous. So the point which you're trying to tell us is that, ladies, if you're stuck in your career, don't check your own potential. Check if you have a good spouse. And I think this is very important. Yeah. It's a very, very important point. But this is about your husband, Deepika. I want to know about your inherent skills, your own inherent skills, which you feel have helped you you know, break this barrier, what you call the glass ceiling, to reach this position. Because, I mean, look around, probably, I think even Ginger has had just one CEO before you, a lady CEO, Sheila Nair, which you mentioned.
That's right.
In fact, most people who I speak to, they believe that you're the first lady CEO. And you corrected me. In that sense, but how did you manage this? And tell us something about your own skills, which has helped you reach here.
Right. So irrespective of gender, if one is looking to want to take on this role of heading a company or business of any kind, I think one key skill that you need is, which one is, of course, the industry specific knowledge, the domain expertise, experience in having worked in that industry, that's a given. But if I look at the personality traits and the softer aspects of it, you're definitely going to lead a lot of people. So be able to, you know, galvanize people around a shared vision, to provide guidance, to be able to look at the organization and look at putting the right people in the right jobs. I think those are the kind of things which requires you to also be a good listener, to be able to understand, you know, where you can connect people's aspirations and what the organization needs, because that's really when magic happens. To be able to look at where your team's strengths are and be able to guide them, communicate that vision. You talked about communication earlier. I think that's key, because you need to be able to break it down, communicate very simply, understand what is the purpose of the organization, what is it that its key stakeholders, its financial stakeholders, or the shareholders want from this organization, then align everybody to it. So it's a lot of being able to distill from what you would engage at a board level down to your entire workforce across all levels. That, I think, requires the ability to comprehend both ends of it and communicate, and also then listen, be able to observe, understand people's talents and their aspirations and align them to what the company needs. So I think this is beyond functional and domain expertise. I think this is what you need to be able to do this role, really.
What a fabulous answer. And you're absolutely right. I think people skills trump domain skills for sure. And this we read in all the books of all CEOs and leaders, and we see it time and again. I mean, everyone wants to work with a people's person, right? And of course, listening is most underrated, but most important. So it's been 3 years you as CEO of Ginger Hotels. So what changes have you seen in your life after sitting on this chair?
In my life, so you're looking at it more personally, I suppose.
Yes, absolutely. In terms of course, I'm going to come to the work-life balance question. But in every sense of
life. Okay, so in my life, one, double down on being more organized. If you were super organized, then become super, super organized. So I think that helps, because you just have to manage more things. That's all. So I think that's one thing. On a lighter note, I think I put on weight initially, because what happened is that somewhere the exercise time honestly did get lost. You spend, maybe the mind was so preoccupied, that inertia set in. I don't know what happened, but I think which may not be necessary in everybody's case, but in my case, it did happen that my scheduled exercise time, I did see slipping away to more thinking time or whatever it was. It definitely, I traded it off with my exercise time, which then I again tried to get back. So I think one has to be consistent with that, but I lost that time.
I think it's not like teething issues.
More in terms of, initially, because you do get overwhelmed right at the beginning when you've got like so much responsibility. What else has changed? So I think one key thing that has also changed for me is that it actually made me a lot more calmer, because you realize that you're going to be dealing with high impacting situations all the time at a higher frequency. So if you're going to be agitated, it's not going to help. So your state of mind needs to be calm, so that you can come up with the best actions that suit that situation. So I think that's something the past 3 years has actually changed as well.
Okay, and I also think it's a key leadership skill, right? To be calm. I think you must be having some percentage of that in you right from the beginning. Otherwise, you wouldn't be there. You wouldn't be there dealing with so many. You're just saying it's got augmented.
Right. Yeah, I think. Sure. Yeah, that's definitely got augmented. I think I mentioned it earlier. Also, to be able to listen, I think that's something which has also, because when you're working with much larger teams and let's just say you're meeting with 8 people, you're discussing an issue, you've got a limited time. So you've got to be able to set the agenda very sharply and get everybody to participate quickly, because time is always of essence. And then to be able to then work out what is it that you all collectively want to go forward with.
Superb, loving it. And asking you more questions.
Sure, so much.
How did it feel when you were informed that you are becoming CEO for the Ginger Group of Hotels?
So I think, Suman, initially, of course, you're just flooded with a lot of calls and a lot of messages and people wishing you good and wishing you well and congratulating you, your parents feeling very proud. So you're dealing with all of that, I think, maybe first 48 hours. And you also feel you feel also privileged with being given that opportunity. But soon, that will die down. I wouldn't give it more than 2 days or 3 days. And then you will realize the level of responsibility and accountability that is on your shoulders, and what expectations are there of you, and that you need to now get into actioning all of that and how you're going to deliver it. So I do talk to a lot of young people who I meet, a lot of TS, new joinees especially, that, be careful what you aspire for. Be cognizant of the second 48 hours. The first 48 hours is not what it is. Life will begin after that, where you will have to realize that you're carrying the responsibility for the whole organization. You're not, the buck will stop with you. You have to make choices. You have to make decisions. Sometimes decisions that are based on not fully available information, but you need to facilitate faster decision-making in ambiguous situations and be accountable for those set of choices that you made. And that's going to be your life thereafter. You will enjoy the journey, because you will see that you've created opportunities for so many people and that you're putting the company on track to realize what it is set out to do. All of that will definitely be fantastic. But I think the most important, which a lot of people tend to think less about, is what it calls for. Be prepared for that part. So that was my experience, Suman.
Since you mentioned, I'll just jump onto the fitness question first, because we have a fitness theme and we have a COVID theme. So wo thoda baad mein puchti hun.
Right.
So, I think you run for fitness. That's what I've read and heard.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
So tell us about your running schedule and do you do anything else?
Right. No. So I actually started with just being a walker because I don't like the indoors. I just can't do anything indoors. For me, exercise means it is an activity which only happens outdoors. The minute I have to be indoors and I won't be, I for sure will only last for one day in a regime like that. So I used to always be someone who did frequent walking. And then I guess, you know, as you need your metabolism slows down, you need to increase the intensity of your exercise. So that's when running actually happened. It started actually more with jogging and then graduated to running. So that's something that now I'm comfortable with. But I'm not like someone who's collects medals across 42 kilometer marathons and all. But I do enjoy pushing my limits, and which is what I think the marathons help you to do. So I do, but you know, races like 10 kilometer runs across multiple events that happen within our city in Mumbai, from the Tata run that happens, and then of course there are other organizations through the year that conduct them. So I've been doing those, so at least two or three. Of course, during COVID there's been a pause on that, but so graduated from being someone who walked regularly to doing 10 kilometer runs. So that's what I do.
The next question is about COVID. As we know, that the tourism and hotel industry was hit the hardest. So how did you navigate this whole period and, you know, the stop which happened with the first wave, then everything started in October. Then again, you know, the second wave, which was like a shock, a global shock. So how did you as, you know, head of hotel chain navigate this?
Well, Suman, this is, thank you for this opportunity, because I think, you know, this personally also for me, I was just about 2 years or so into this role, and honestly, this crisis wasn't something which was small. It ended up being something I think we'll say it was once in a decade or probably once in a lifetime. Our first response as a team when this lockdown was announced is that we said, why don't we ensure that everybody stays in the hotels itself, whether they're on our rolls or they're not on our rolls or on service contracts, irrespective of that, let's house everybody in the hotel. Because if they were to all head out to transport hubs to get back to their hometowns, and if they are stuck in between, it's just going to cause a lot of panic for everybody back at their homes. And we thought that maybe it's not a long drawn thing. Honestly, I think all of us didn't know that, you know, every 7 days after that, we'll hear the Prime Minister extending it. You know, we all thought at first it was by first week of April, things will lift up. That also made it look like a temporary situation. So I said, let's keep everybody in house. When I look back, I think that decision helped us also bounce back when business came. And I'm really proud of our team's agility, because business did not come back in the same avatar that we're used to. Business was very different. There was business in the form of Vande Bharat flights. There was business in the form of healthcare workers. There was a business in the form of quarantine tie-ups with hospitals. So it required new relationships to be stitched. It required new protocols to be put in place, whether it's something as simple as cleaning a room had to be completely reassessed, whether it was about serving.
Yeah.
So when I think back and look at how we traversed this whole journey, we ended up having the highest revenue recovery compared to pre-COVID in FY21 across the industry. We did 63% of our FY20 revenues in FY21. And all of that was possible because of agility, because of organizing ourselves. And I really think one of the key things for me, which has been a takeaway, is to we always underrate action versus thinking. You know, in a moment of crisis, when people are given things to do, your mind gets occupied. You have a set of actions to do, which delivers certain outcomes. That also feedbacks a nice virtuous feel cycle of feeling good that you're making a difference, you know. So immediately we came up with a We organized ourselves along four verticals, you know, revenue, expense, cash management, and process redefinition. Then we assigned various groups to each of them. And again, here we were looking at things very traditionally. You know, suppose we had to actually go to landlords and seek lease rent waivers or deferments. It's not necessarily those who are in finance or legal who will do those. It would be where the relationship lies with that owner. Sometimes the relationship could be with the one who originally did the deal. It could be with somebody who's managing that asset today. Irrespective of where it is, we quickly put down things that we had to do under a strategy that we called REAP. And that was our COVID response framework. So it was, you know, and we said we made various stakeholders in charge of these. They created teams. And so we were already entirely in the mode of action. So when you are into that mode of action and when you're chasing certain outcomes and pursuing things, it takes out the whole process of, oh, why has this happened? That's already happened. Now you have to react to what is happening. You can't keep sitting in the zone of why has this happened? How long will it last? You need to take action here and now. So, you know, in quarter one, we did almost 44% of the revenue that we did for quarter one of FY21, I'm talking about, you know, the first quarter when the first wave happened, we did 44% of the previous quarter one. And then that ramped up to mid-60s. Then we reached about early, end mid-60s towards the end of quarter four and finished the whole year at 63%. So I think, so when I look back at a crisis and one's response to it and how you handle it, and then again, the second wave happened and this time it hit closer home. We had to actually had cases coming in from within our entire workforce. So again, you know, you had to respond to that. You had to provide support to the employee or their extended families. Again, the business started drying up. You had to go back and reignite those relationships with hospitals and again, get back to looking at pandemic related business that exists. So in all this, just two things, you know, act. And the second thing I think is agility. And of course, I cannot underline the importance of communication because every week I was addressing all the employees as to what we did this week, what are we going to do next week, how are we conserving cash, how are we trying to generate cash. So there's very clear that in the short term, medium term, cash is going to be the most important thing. And cash can come from multiple ways, whether you collect, whether you try to get new revenues or old dues, or you defer expense payments, or you negotiate waivers. So once we knew that there was a set of actions to be performed, you need to know that you can manage the situation. I think that's really what my experience has been. And of course, now we got through the second wave as well. We just finished our second quarter. The results have been good. Well, recovery looks like it is not a staccato thing. Looks like it is here to stay. I mean, even if one cannot say how the cases will go up or down, but clearly what seems to be the writing on the wall is economic activity will not get significantly impacted. It will continue at a certain pace. So hopefully we, maybe not out of the woods, but we're on the path.
Sitting ovation. I think whatever you said is going to guide a lot of people who are finding themselves stuck and confused. And in fact, to pull from an earlier answer which you gave, you know, that things will keep happening and you have to be calm, you know.
Right.
In other words, you said, sab moh maya hai, just apna kaam karte chalo, just take it one at a time and do what you have control over.
Correct, correct, absolutely.
That's a brilliant answer. Thank you.
And when you do things that you have control over, no, you stop feeling that the unthinkable is happening with me because you're changing your today. If you have the power to change your today with small actions, then you're not in the defeatist mindset that I'm overwhelmed. You come out of that to saying that I've changed it. Right? Today I made these three calls. I got so much reduction that's helped us in this much. Suddenly there's value in your being, in your handling the situation. I think that helps.
Yes, absolutely. And it's a beautiful answer. And it's going to teach everyone who's watching this interview. It's really, thank you for that. Okay, work-life balance. So your daughter is 7 and now she can speak her mind. So
yes.
How do you navigate? Because I think for a CEO, the mails never stop coming and there's always something on the to-do list. So
yeah, that's true. And I think the best, I mean, I'm also still navigating it, Suman, you know, so I'm not at the end of the tunnel to look back. But what I think is that what I'm doing right now is that I ensure that she partners me in everything. Like she almost knows my job. Because if she understands it better, and I can, you can always break down things for a child in a way that they can comprehend sufficiently. So I do that. I ensure that she partners me in it. And when that happens, she starts getting excited about it. She never gets nervous about things. She gets only excited about things. And that helps because, you know, that you just communicate with her. I tell her, like, if I have an important meeting, I tell her. I even tell her what are the expectations from me from that meeting and therefore why I have to prepare for that.
Oh.
So I'm just going about it and I break it down into small nuggets of things that she can comprehend. And now because COVID put us all at home, she's already picked up all the nomenclatures that we use, you know. So budget has become a part of her lexicon already. So
And you're getting some really creative ideas, fresh ideas, you know, chief creative officer, she must be.
So she kind of understands that maybe at the moment, I think I'm doing a decent job at it in terms of communicating to her and why I enjoy to work. I mean, whatever I, today's hotels, whatever I do, I like to work. I don't see that I'm a better mom because I get to do what I enjoy doing. So that puts me in a very happy space. And if I'm in a happy space, I can do fun things with her. If I'm going to be in a sad space, I'm not going to be able to do fun things with her. And that's really the quality time that we spend together. So she likes to see a mom who's engaged, who feels her life is valuable for some reason. And therefore, I can make a difference to companies, to colleagues, and then it just makes me a much better mother. And we do more fun things together. So, I mean, I must share this morning, I went for a walk, a run to the park. I came back and she was upset, you know, because we had spoken that I'll wake her up and I'll take her also with me. But I thought, you know, maybe let her sleep in a little bit and all. And I didn't bother to wake her up. So I actually had to go back to the park, which is really distraught. And I was on the clock and I said, okay, I have a 10:30 meeting. But I knew like, okay, I have like half an hour to figure out things. So we actually packed breakfast and ate it at the park. I said, abhi kuch to multitasking I have to do. I don't have the luxury of taking her to the park, then coming back, doing breakfast, showering and leaving. So then, you know, I said, why don't we have a picnic and let's have breakfast at the park. So she immediately managed to pick up one little cane basket from somewhere. We threw in our breakfast. We went. So I got time with her. She was happy. I finished my breakfast. So, and then it's just adjacent to my home. So I guess it's just about engaging her with my life and not compartmentalizing it and not shutting her off from it, because that doesn't help. The more I can make her a part of it, she understands it better. And maybe the proof of the pudding is whether I'm doing a decent job of this is when you ask my daughter Radha today that, you know, what do you want to be in? Usual questions that somebody asks in the house at some time. So she says that, you know, she wants to be exactly like what mama does. I want to work with Ginger Hotels and do what.
Wow, so cute.
Maybe I've managed to communicate it in some way to her that she thinks it's a fun thing. So
cute. And I think you've also said a few things like, you know, you're creatively using limited time.
Right.
And I think just multitasking and, you know, stretching your hours by making her a part of it. So then she doesn't feel you're missing, which is, again, these are fabulous ideas for working mothers. It's really, really good fun. Last two questions. Is age a barrier? As you know, this channel is about women achievers over the age of 40. And do you feel that being over 40 is a barrier, or does it help you in certain ways?
In performing this role specifically, you mean? Like, no, I mean, actually, I think age is quite frankly irrelevant for whatever one chooses to do. And, you know, I keep saying it that in Ginger, the way we've reconceived the whole product, the transformation we're doing with the brand is we're speaking to people who now live life in a very non-linear fashion. You know, earlier you study, then you earn, and then you keep earning, and then you stop earning, right? I mean, that's how it used to happen. We see things very non-linear today. You know, people actually exit the workforce to study, right? People are picking up a hobby past 60. People are, you know, doing some adventure sport where you think you should have done that in your 20s, they're actually picking it up, or learning swimming maybe when they're 55 or whatever. What is definitely paying out, even in the Indian cultural, social setup, is a very non-linear fashion about marriage, about children, about hobbies, about learning, about studying. So I think it's an exciting time for all of us, you know. So I don't know whether 40, this side of 40 or that side of 40 is right for what. I think it's, you know, for what, really. So if I leave the biological clock aspects aside, because that's not in one's control, but otherwise, I think you just choose to be what you want to be at what time you want to be. And if you believe in it, then you can do it at really honestly any age. But one thing for sure is that I think sometimes with age, some of us tend to start becoming very rigid. I mean, our thoughts start getting firmed up because life teaches you and you think. So I guess certain things when you do it slightly like maybe mid-30s to early 40s, wherein you need to have a more open mind, you know, I think it helps at those points, you know, like maybe marriage is an institution also. I think sometimes it's better a little earlier when your mind isn't too strongly opinionated on many subjects. You've got to coexist, for which you really need an open mind. But otherwise, I think work-wise, really, I don't think age should limit anything. But again, it just comes back to a mindset. If you can, even at 55, if you can be somebody who keeps an open mind, you're a good listener, sure. I mean, I think a lot of fun stuff can happen then also. So,
what is your perception of recruiting women above the age of 40? And this is a very important conversation for me because, in fact, it has sparked this whole idea of this channel. Since I spoke to a couple of friends who were, head of placement firms, and there was a CHRO, of an international company. And they actually said that, you know, you have to read between the lines. And a lot of times we reject resumes of both genders above 35. So is this so? And because again, as we know that women take it easy, or they, take a step back when the kids are smaller. Not everyone has a supportive spouse. Not everyone has a good support system. Mm-hmm. In nuclear families, and lot of people in Bombay are in nuclear families just because of the cost of, city. Mm-hmm. How do you as a CEO perceive a resume of women above 40?
So I guess I wouldn't just look only at age and a resume and say, okay, let's pass this. You need to meet that person and, you know, get a sense that what do you feel about the person? What's the kind of vibe you get? And maybe in our specific case, Suman, maybe just to close this point, is that we're a very young organization and our average age is 25. We don't really hire because my HODs are also of a certain age. Because then how do you meet their career aspirations? They'll tend to plateau. Nothing to do with gender, just with the fact that you're already a fairly young organization. There are probably 4 or 5 jobs which require that level of experience. So now
and you need to grow through the ranks.
People in the ranks, yeah, because then you give growth to those people. So they will be hiring in that age group, but maybe it's only going to be 3 or 4 in a year. Not more.
So I think again, the hotel industry is physically quite demanding. So after 40, we are running right for the metabolism. So definitely things are on a decline. So Deepika, last question. If you could give some advice to women over the age of 40. And in your case, I specifically request that, you know, women who are leading or aspire to lead in male bastions, what would that advice be?
Now, I was saying one key piece of advice is that I think we should take ourselves less seriously and enjoy the journey, because when we take ourselves so seriously, we tend to stress and get into those emotions that come with it. So I think enjoy the journey, keep a good set of people around you, both in the team as well as at home, and you'll be just fine. Don't be super critical of yourself. Pat yourself on the back more often than you do. Maybe don't wait for somebody else. You can yourself pat yourself on the back. So I think move from being too self-critical to enjoying your small successes, and then the journey becomes a lot easier. I would say that.
Thank you. Thank you so much for this time and for this fabulous interview. Okay, it was frozen. So the Zoom link doesn't like this word yoga. So it was frozen.
I think so, yeah. It's crashed it.
I just can't wait to have this out there. So thank you so much.
I will go under the radar. Just let me know one day before.
You're watching Not Just Auntie with Sumana Deepali.